Let's stand together and let's open up with prayer. Father, again, we are just so grateful, Lord, for the rain that you sent our way and the breaking of the heat dome that was over us for so long. God, we're just so thankful for just your common grace in our lives every single day, Lord. You do a billion different things on our behalf every day that we're not even aware of. And Lord, all we know to do is say thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. We assemble together here again this beautiful evening, Lord, to worship your name. We ask you, Lord, that you would crucify our flesh and fill us with your Holy Spirit. We pray, God, that you would just come and inhabit the singing and the praises of your people. God, we pray that you would help the preacher to preach. Lord, I know without you I can do nothing. Lord, we thank you we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And Lord, I just would ask you for your anointing and your filling. Lord, bring to my remembrance tonight all things that you have spoken, and I pray that my brothers and sisters would listen with that kind of listening we spoke about this morning to read and hear and obey what your word says. Lord, we commit this service to you, and we commit it to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I love to tell a story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell a story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. Story more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story, it did so much for me. One eternal day, there comes
Pray together. Father, thank you that we are bound for the promised land because of the sacrifice that you've made on our behalf, Lord. What a privilege to gather together, assemble together tonight, Lord. What a privilege one more time, Lord, that you've afforded to us to bring our tithes and our offerings in worship to Jesus Christ, the King of Kings. Lord, we pray that you would be glorified through the giving of this offering, and also, Lord, now, prepare our hearts to receive with meekness the engrafted word. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand again and let's sing together.
When the war is over and the battles are done, we shall see our Savior shining like the sun. He will cry, every shadow will flee, all those in Christ Jesus will be made complete, will be made complete. Come, Lord Jesus, listen to creation grow. Come, Lord Jesus, come and take your people home. Every tongue will praise him. When listen to creation roar. Come, Lord Jesus, come and take your people home.
Well, for a while anyway, open your Bibles the last time to the book of Revelation, chapter 22, and tonight we'll see the concluding verses of this great book of the Bible, Revelation 22, verse 13 through verse 21. We see that the Revelation closes the same way it opened, with Jesus and His church. The book opens with these words, the revelation of Jesus Christ, Revelation 1:1. And then Jesus immediately reveals that the book is to be sent, quote, unto the seven churches, Revelation 1:11 through Revelation 3:22. And here the book closes in Revelation 22 with, I, Jesus, have sent my angel, verse 16, to testify unto you these things in the churches. This reveals what's on the heart of Jesus Christ, His church. He closes the way He started with His church. When Jesus speaks, His first words are of His church. Christ doesn't reveal Himself to man without revealing His church. And we learn in Revelation chapter 3 and 4 and in all of the Bible that when our Lord speaks of the church, He's speaking of a local church in a local town with a local pastor and local people who have been saved by Christ's sacrificial death on the cross. Jesus Christ loved the church. You could say Jesus Christ loved the local church and gave Himself for her, Ephesians 5:25. Even those words were written to a local church. The church is the bride, the Lamb's wife, Revelation 21:9. There is no loving Jesus apart from loving His local church. It's God that ordained it that way. It has been the highest honor for me and the greatest privilege, as God calls the pastor, his angel, the angel of Shelbyville Mills Baptist Church, Revelation 2 and 3. It's been the greatest privilege and desire of my heart to testify unto you these things in the church, to preach this inspired book to you. I pray that it has helped you to understand how redemption's story ends on this earth. I have prayed for you all along that it would aid your sanctification and your personal holiness. I pray that it makes you long for heaven and it calls you to watch and to wait for the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ more than you ever have at any point in your life. I can only testify to you that the verse-by-verse study of the Revelation the last 2 years and 8 months has helped round out my theology and give me a better, fuller, richer understanding of eschatology. For the first time in my life and ministry, even though I've preached much of the prophetic literature, I feel that the Lord has helped me to have a better grasp on how the story ends. And for that, I am eternally grateful. And Revelation chapters 19, 20, 21, and 22 have been somewhat of a personal revival for me. As I mentioned in my last sermon, last Sunday, or the week that was before the fall outreach, I would fall into that camp with you, and I was honest about that, of having merely a general concept of heaven, just a general understanding that heaven is a place that we go to when we die. But since studying the Revelation, and since studying the new heaven and the new earth and the new Jerusalem, Revelation 21, 1 through 22, 5, I have an excitement in my heart about eternity. I have an anticipation in my soul about heaven that I've never had before. I understand better what heaven is going to be like. I understand better what life in heaven is going to be like. And I find myself thinking about heaven. I find myself meditating about heaven. I find myself longing for heaven. As we've sung Romans chapter 8, I find my heart groaning with the Spirit, waiting for the adoption of the sons of God. I long to see the Lamb. I long to see my Heavenly Father. Like Rebecca of old, one of my favorite passages, Genesis 24, when Rebecca was the one God chose to marry Isaac, and Abraham's servant on that long journey taught Rebecca everything that he knew about Isaac. My learning of Jesus has produced in me a longing for Jesus. And now I find myself looking for Jesus. And I pray that you're right there with me. As a God-called pastor teacher, here is the message of revelation from God to me. And this is the message to every God-called preacher. From the beginning of your ministry to the end of time, preach Christ to the church. Preach heaven to the church. Preach the word to the church. Love the church. Serve the church. Stand with the church. Fight for the church. Protect the church. Pray for the church. Give your strength and time and energy for the church. Never be distracted from the church. Give all you have to Christ for His glory in the church. And raise up men who will do the same thing when death ends your time as a God-called pastor. As Paul said in Ephesians 3:21, unto Christ be glory in the church, or rather unto Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, listen to this, world without end, amen. Ephesians 3:21. World without end. In eternity, it will still be all about Christ and Christ's glory in the church. There is no greater calling. There is no higher endeavor. There is no greater work than to be completely given to Jesus and serving Him through His church. Let me just say, if you don't get the church, you get nothing. If you don't understand that, if you don't get the local church, for all of your knowledge and all of your understanding, you have missed it all. Unto Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Even in the age to come, it's going to be about Christ and His church. So I have taken my title right from the text, and here it is, our last message. Testify unto these things in the churches. Those are among the last words that are recorded Christ speaking in the New Testament. Testify unto these things in the churches. Stand with me in reverence to reading the last verses of the Revelation. Jesus speaking, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. For without or outside are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. For I testify unto you, every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book, if any man shall add to these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this book of prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in the book. He which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. And Father, may that be. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Church, would you be seated? Christ here says in verse 16, I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. The word testify is a frequently used word in Greek, martyreo. We get our English word martyr from this word. It means to bear an honest and an accurate witness to who Jesus Christ is and to what He has accomplished. It is a call to be a faithful witness. It's often translated witness, testify. It's a call to be a faithful witness even unto death. And the Revelation closes with eight things my Lord has commanded me to testify unto you, the church. Number one, Jesus is to be the subject of all preaching in the church. Jesus is to be the subject of all preaching in the church. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Every young preacher taking a course in Greek is required oftentimes before the course even starts to memorize the Greek alphabet, because it is upon that alphabet that all the words he will learn to help him interpret the word are built. Alpha is the first word of the Greek alphabet. Omega is the last. The Greek alphabet begins with Alpha and it ends with Omega. And in the same way, Jesus Christ is the subject of all we testify to. Christ is the subject of all we preach. Christ is the subject of our witness. Christ is the subject of our mission work. No matter the text we're preaching, no matter the text we're teaching in small groups, we are to use that text to preach the finished work of Christ. Every ministry, every fall outreach, every visitation blitz, every mission trip, every youth camp, every VBS, every college and career retreat, every kids camp is to testify to the death, the burial, the resurrection, and the imminent coming of Jesus, regardless of what text we may be using. It's been attributed to Spurgeon, though I will acknowledge that there are some who don't know for sure that it's attributed to him. But it's said that Spurgeon once said, quote, "I take my text and I make a beeline to the cross." Well, let me just say, whether Spurgeon said it or not, that's good preaching. It's to take any text of the Scripture and wherever you are, preach the Alpha and the Omega, everything in between, the subject of our preaching and our witness and our missions endeavor. We are to preach Christ and Him crucified. Amen? He is the subject of all preaching in the church. Here's a second truth. Jesus is to be obeyed in the church. Look at verse 14. "Blessed are they that do His commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city." Well, we have studied those gates, have we not? And we have studied the tree of life, Revelation 22:2. We've studied the gates, Revelation 21:12 through 13 and 21. And they speak of eternal life. They speak of heaven. And here Jesus reveals who has the right, exousia, who has the authority, who has the privilege to enter in through those gates. Are you listening to me? They that do His commandments. Christ is revealing here the identifying mark of a true believer. And here it is. It's not that he repeated a prayer. It's not that he raised his hand in some meeting. It's not that he caught the preacher's eye at the appropriate time in the invitation. No. Christ is revealing that the identifying mark of a true believer is that he follows and obeys the teaching of Jesus. This is something that is impossible to you before you're converted. But when you're saved, God creates within you, with the help of His Spirit, the ability to obey the commands of Christ. At conversion, we are given the grace to obey. This is evidence of our conversion. And this is those who will enter in through the gates. I challenge you, as the Bible does, look to your fruit. You say you've been converted, test yourself. Examine yourself in light of sacred Scripture. Are you, since the day you say you've been saved, are you an obedient follower of Jesus Christ? It does not mean that we never sin, but it does mean that the consistent pattern of our lives is one of obeying and following the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the subject of preaching in the church. Jesus is to be obeyed in the church. Amen? Number three, Revelation teaches us another concluding thing. Jesus is wrathful toward those who do not obey. Jesus is wrathful toward those who do not obey. Look at verse 15. The King James Version says, "For without," or outside of those gates, "and well beyond the tree of life and the river of life, are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers and idolaters, and whosoever loveth and maketh a lie. You know what sickens me about our country more today than anything? You know what sickens me today about our world more than anything? It's all the whoremongers and sorcerers and murderers and idolaters who say they love Jesus. It's sickening. They're condemned by their own words. Jesus makes it absolutely clear that all those who practice these things are outside of heaven. That means, Revelation 20:15, they are in the lake of fire. This is now at least the third time in two chapters that Jesus Christ has given specific lists of people who will perish and not be allowed into heaven because they do not obey His commands. Christ repeats this warning three times, pleading with sinners to repent, pleading with sinners to turn from sin, pleading with sinners to come by faith to Jesus Christ. And He says, here's a group of people that will not be allowed into heaven. Dogs. I remember I was in the first weeks of my ministry as the new pastor at Shelbyville Mills Baptist Church. And the first book I preached through was the book of Philippians. And I did something with no help. When I was studying my message, I came to Philippians chapter 3, verse 2, and it simply says, beware of the dogs. If you were here then, you remember that. Every entrance of our church had a sign that said, beware of the dogs. People thought, man, what's going on? Our church has lost its mind. Until they came and I explained. In Philippians chapter 3, that's Paul's way of warning of false teachers, listen to me, who were mingling law and ritual with grace as a means of salvation. Jesus and Paul were not very benevolent to them. They called them dogs. Now, don't think about your little Yorkie poo or your poodle. In Jesus' day, dogs were not domesticated. They were diseased-carrying scavengers. As we will see, anyone who perverts the gospel of Jesus Christ, Jesus says, is a dog. And they will be outside of heaven. False teachers and false preachers will pay an unbelievably high price, eternity in the lowest hell, for deceiving those whom they led astray. Jesus said, outside of this beautiful place, the new Jerusalem of eternity of heaven, the new heaven and new earth that we've just studied, outside are dogs. And then He says, sorcerers, pharmakos. We get our English word pharmacy from this word. It has been used through 2,000 years of church history to describe those who abused drugs and alcohol and thus were led away from the gospel of Christ. And by the way, do we not live in a drug-crazed culture? I'll tell you, our culture's going to hell if it doesn't repent. Carrying its drugs and alcohol with it. We see just this week in our own church a warning, a shot across the bow from Almighty God. The danger, the deadly danger of drugs and alcohol. Outside are dogs and outside are sorcerers. And then He says, and boy, if this is not America, outside of heaven are whoremongers. All of these Greek words are powerful. Pornos. We get our word pornography from this word. It's a general term that the Holy Spirit uses to describe anyone who lives a lifestyle of sexual perversion. It could be fornication, which means to have sex before you get married. It's illegal, it's wrong, it's sinful, and God says don't do it. As a matter of fact, He says flee from it. It could be adultery, and that means that you're married and you have sex with someone else who's married. It's the homosexual who is attracted to the same sex and carries out those perverted sexual desires. It's the lesbian, the woman who's sexually attracted to another woman and carries out those perverted sexual desires, and they are perverted. It's the polygamist who has multiple wives. And it's the pornographer who looks at pornography and lusts in his or her heart. All who practice such things, all who live in such things, Jesus said, will be outside of heaven. The Bible repeats this again and again and again and again. They will not be allowed into heaven. Doesn't matter how many smiling preachers there are. Doesn't matter how many mega churches there are with shiny lights and shiny suits and all kinds of well-oiled programs. At the end, they're going to hell if they don't repent and turn from their sin. This is Jesus speaking. Outside are dogs and sorcerers and whoremongers and murderers. It means to take human life. It could be to intentionally murder someone, or it could be the well-dressed doctor in a white, pure white clinical lab coat that murders babies through abortion. He will have his part in the lake of fire. Don't care how many degrees he has. It's going to be a lot more degrees. If he doesn't repent and turn to Jesus Christ, if she doesn't repent and turn to Christ. And then he says idolaters. And these are those that worship any other god than the Father and the Son. Now there's something subtle here that I just can't let slip by. Did we not see this morning that John practiced a form of idolatry? We did, didn't we? He bowed down and worshiped an angel. The angel rebuked him. He ceased and desisted. In other words, John sinned. He made a mistake. But when corrected, man, his heart was broken and he yielded. Look, John was not a habitual idolater. Idolatry did not describe John's life. We're not talking about some one-time isolated event here where a brother got caught up in the wrong thing. We're talking about a practice, a lifestyle of being a sorcerer and a whoremonger and a murderer and an idolater. He's talking about this is who these people are. And he says, liars. Revelation 21:8, Revelation 21:27. And now Revelation 22 verse 15, repeat it again and again and again. No liar will be allowed into heaven. Now I'll raise my hand so you won't be embarrassed. How many of you in this room have ever lied? Let me be first. Yes, this proves the whole point I said about John's idolatry. It happened, but it wasn't who he was. Do you see that? It happened, but it doesn't prove who he was, which is why I said what I said this morning, giving me hope for Miguel. It happened, but on the other side of conversion, there was a clear, consistent pattern that he loved Christ. We have great hope that our brother is with Christ. We're not talking about an isolated event. We're talking about a habitual lifestyle of these things. Look, every person in this room may have lied, but if you're born again, you are not a liar. Do you see the difference? He's talking about people here who it's their nature to lie, and they lie intentionally, and they lie to deceive, and they lie for gain, and they lie to hurt others. He says they are outside. They will not be within the gates. They will not drink of the river of life. They will not eat the fruit of the tree of life. They will be in the lake of fire. These are the words of the Jesus Christ revealed in this book. Now, if you add to what he said to lessen these sins, you'll get the plagues that are in this book. Or if you take away from the veracity of what he says here, you will be taken out of heaven and be outside with the rest of these dogs and murderers and sorcerers. Amen? Do you see what he's saying? So for all of the relevant churches, for all of the pragmatic churches today, for all the churches that take a niche sin and market themselves to it, they'll all be in the lake of fire. All of them. They are deceivers, they are false prophets, they are liars, they are leading souls astray. And don't you ever, ever, ever be guilty of saying, well, my cousin goes to a church, now it's not a healthy church, and they don't really preach a true gospel, but I'm just glad he's in church. That is insanity. Let me just be honest with you. I'd rather my son never step foot in a church than to be in one like that. He's not going to get to heaven through adulterated preaching. It eternally matters. Do you realize there are going to be more people outside than there are inside? And it's due in large part to false preaching and false teachers. I'm telling you, they are dogs and devils. And Christ has reserved the lowest hell for those who add to the word and for those who take away from it. Both lead people to the lake of fire. Strict judgment will fall upon all who do such a thing. There's a fourth truth here as we consider the close of this book. Jesus reveals himself in his church. Jesus reveals himself in his church. Look at verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. If you're listening, say amen. The true God, the one God, the only God, listen, is the God of Israel. Here it's called the New Jerusalem. The names of the 12 tribes of Israel are inscribed on the walls of heaven. The city itself is defined as Jerusalem. And here Jesus, how does he identify himself? I'm the root of David, and I'm the offspring of David. Jesus is the promised one that the Israelite prophets prophesied of. Jesus is the Messiah. He's the Messiah of Israel. Jesus is the son of David. Listen to the way Matthew opens his gospel. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Yahweh is the true and the living God, the only God. And here he reveals himself also as the bright and morning star. Numbers 24:17 says this, there shall come a star out of Jacob, that's Israel. There shall come a star out of Jacob, a scepter shall rise up out of Israel and shall smite the corners of Moab and destroy the children of Sheth. It says there shall be a star of Jacob. Jesus is that star. Jesus is that bright and morning star. Unto the local church at Thyatira, Jesus said, I will give unto him the morning star. Revelation 2:28. As the morning star announces the end of night and the dawn of day, so the coming of Jesus announces the end of the night of cruel Satan's reign and the end of sinful man and the dawning of a new heaven and a new earth. Jesus Christ, 1 Peter 1:19, is our day star. He is the root and offspring of David. He is the bright and morning star. Jesus reveals himself in his church. Number five. Jesus empowers his church in its mission. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. As you and I go forth bearing precious gospel seed, often weeping, we know that our Lord is with us, even to the end of the age. Matthew 28:19-20. But here our Lord allows us to see two invitations that reveal he empowers us to fulfill our mission. We, the church, can call upon him to empower us. Look at the text. The Spirit and the bride say, come. The bride is the church. The Spirit is the Holy Spirit. We, the church, can and must call upon the Spirit of God to help us obey his commands, to carry out testifying to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the Spirit of God joins in with us in crying out to God for help. Paul said the Spirit helps our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for. But the Spirit himself intercedes for the saints with groanings which cannot be uttered, Romans 8:26. And here Christ answers our prayer with his own invitation. Let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. Thirst is a gift from God. Thirst motivates you to seek him. And if you will come to Jesus, if you will come to Christ, you can take of the water of life freely. Anyone who sincerely desires Christ, anyone who sincerely reaches out to him for the living water will receive it. What a precious promise we as the church have when we proclaim this gospel. We can rest assured that when we gather here on Sunday, we can rest assured that when the word is preached or we go abroad on a mission trip, when we have a fall outreach, when we have a camp, that our Lord will take the word and through his Spirit sincerely invite people to come and drink, to sincerely invite people to take of the water of life freely. What a precious promise we have. Jesus empowers his church in mission. Are you beginning to see it's all about the church? Number six, he teaches us how to preach his word in the church. He teaches us how to preach the word in the church. Look at verse 18. I testify unto every man that heareth the words of this prophecy of this book, if any man shall add unto these things, you know, that means going beyond what the scripture says and giving your testament about things. If any man shall add to these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out of the holy city, and from the things that were written in the book. Now let me ask you a question. Will he do it? Will he do it? When we preach the revelation, or when we preach any portion of God's word, we are not to add anything to it. Amen? We're not to take away anything from it. I'll tell you, in Southern Baptist churches, pastors are far guilty of the latter than they are the earlier. I don't see a lot of Southern Baptist preachers adding things to the Word of God, but they will knowingly withhold portions of Scripture from their church to keep their job. That's called taking away. We're not to add to the Word. We're not to take away from the Word. What are we to do? Preach the Word. 2 Timothy 4:2. We are to be faithful to the written word of God and preach it as the Holy Spirit gave it to us. Precept upon precept, line upon line. But the context, the strict context, is the book of Revelation. There's a warning to all who try to explain this book away by being merely symbolic. Many outright avoid it. Many won't even preach the book of Revelation. They won't even acknowledge it because they can't accept what it clearly says. This is extremely dangerous, and it invites the judgment of God described on those in these verses. In the Revelation and in every book I preach to you, my goal is to say only what the text is saying. Here's what the Apostle Paul said. I take record unto you this day that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God, Acts 20:26-27. You see, Jesus teaches us how to preach his word in his church. It's his word and it's his church. Amen? Number seven, it's all about the church, isn't it? The book opens with Jesus and the church, and the book closes with Jesus and the church. The seventh thing he testifies to the churches is this: Jesus is coming soon for his church. We saw that this morning. This is the third time now he has said it, just in a few verses. He that testifies these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Since I spent so much time on it this morning, I want this evening, but this speaks of the imminent coming of Christ, and that is, as I taught you, that it could happen any moment. Jesus says, surely I come quickly. And here the church responds, amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. I tell you, the heart of any person who's truly been born again, there is a deep desire, a deep longing for Jesus to come again. It's growing, and some of us are more intense levels than others, but in the heart of every redeemed child of God, there is, as Romans 8 says, and we sung about it tonight, we groan within ourselves. We groan with creation, waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our bodies. Jesus has said he's coming quickly, and the church shouts, amen! Come, Lord Jesus. And then lastly, the eighth thing Jesus tells us to testify in his churches is that Jesus dispenses his grace in his church. Look at verse 21. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. I have to tell you, I pause for a moment. My heart palpitates. A sense of awe comes over me this evening, and knowing this day was coming. The last words of the Holy Bible. Let that sink in. The last words of the ancient Word of God. I just want to cry, holy, holy, holy. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Brothers and sisters, this is holy ground. Until he comes, every time we assemble together, the grace of Jesus Christ be with you all. When we leave this assembly and when we go out into the world, the grace of Jesus Christ be with you all. When we witness, Christ be with you all. When we're on mission, Christ be with you all. When we're opposed, Christ be with you all. When we're afflicted, Christ be with you all. When we come to draw our last breath, Christ be with you all. And until the very day Jesus Christ comes again, Christ be with you all. And he will be with you all with much grace, charis. It means he'll be with you in loving favor. He'll be with you in loving acceptance. He'll be with you in joy. He'll be with you in delight. He'll be with you in sweetness. He'll be with you in charm. He'll be with you in loveliness. He will be with you with his goodwill. All of this are words which describe grace. His loving kindness, his favor will be with you all. And then finally, one day, we'll see him face to face in all of his glory. We began this race with grace, and we'll finish it with grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. No wonder Newton said, "'Tis grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. To God be the glory." Let's stand together and pray. Jesus, thank you that you introduced this book in five words, the revelation of Jesus Christ, and then you immediately turn and address the churches. And we come to the close of the book, and your heart and your motive has not moved an inch. I, Jesus Christ, have sent my angel to testify unto these things in the churches. You did not give us Revelation to argue and debate eschatology. You did not give us the book of Revelation to sit around and have lively theological debates. You gave us the revelation of Jesus Christ to prepare us to meet our King and our Lord and our God. And we need your grace to do that, Lord. We need your grace to run this race. And we trust your words that you will be with us all. I will never leave thee, I will never forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man shall do to me. God, I pray that through this great study of Revelation, you would sanctify us, purify us, make our wedding garments white, and prepare us for our wedding day. And we cry with the apostles and prophets that have gone before us, even so, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, Lord Jesus, come. It's for your name and for your glory we pray, Christ. Amen.
Savior leads me, move I'd ask beside. How could I doubt His tender mercy? Who through life has been my guide? All the way my Savior leads me, cheers each winding path I tread, and gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with living breath. You lead me and keep me from falling. You care me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow me all the way, my Savior leads me. Hold the fullness of the sureness of His promise, in the triumph of His blood, when my spirit clothed in warm wings of light around our day, and this my song through endless days. Jesus led me all the way. Jesus led me all the way. You lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and sure. Will follow me. You lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will follow. Will follow me all the way, my Savior leads me. All the way, my Savior leads me.
Amen, church. Tetelestai. At least this part, it is finished. Amen. What a joy it's been. Would you be seated for just a moment? And praise the team, if y'all would just take a seat for just a minute. I don't want y'all just have to stand. But I wanted to bring to you guys tonight two unanimous motions from all the pastors and all the deacons. And I'll give just a little bit of explanation, and then if you would, just listen to me, and then we'll take a look at the sheet. Motion number one, Well, let me back up before I do that and tell you this. Brother Jeff said something to me a few weeks ago, and I guess this is just the way I am. It's not fake. It's not phony. But this is the way my dad raised me, and this is the way the Lord has taught me since I was saved. You just do your job. You do your job. You work hard, and you do your job, and you bear up under pressure, and you persevere. And that's just the way I've been raised and the way that I've been taught. And Brother Jeff said something to me the other day. He said, you know, Brother John O, you go to the pulpit week in and week out, and man, you preach revelation, and your heart's on fire. And he said, everybody, your people just look and say, man, old Brother John O, he's doing okay. And sometimes that can be a little bit deceiving. Brother Ryan and I have been under an unbelievable weight. It has been unbelievably heavy. I can't even tell you the weight and the burden that we have been under, being two staff, two pastor ministry team since Brother Joe's resignation. It has just been extremely weighty and extremely heavy, and it's taken its toll on both of us, and we know and we've known from the beginning that this is not sustainable. It's not something we can carry on long term. So we've been praying and we've been discussing where we go from here and what we do. Motion number one, where's Brian? Brian and Olivia Huffer, if y'all would stand up there in the middle. I think everybody knows Brian and Olivia. They've been with us for a good while. Y'all all say hey. y'all can be seated. Brian has surrendered to preach. He has surrendered to a divine call on his life to preach the word. And man, it is just so obvious. God has his hand on this young man. He's preaching when he has opportunities. He's preached at Grace Life Church three times the last couple of months or so, or last month, I'd say. He's going through the Pastoral Training Institute, and I just affirm as his pastor, Brian is going to be a senior pastor. There's just no doubt about it. But I have talked with Brian about helping me out on Wednesday nights, and he's graciously agreed to this per your approval. And all of the pastors and deacons have agreed to this, that we want to hire Brother Brian on a part-time basis for 6 months. At the end of 6 months, we'll evaluate that, because I don't want to tie Brian up too much because of God's call on his life. At the end of 6 months, if we're able to go another 6 months, we'll do that. But I want to keep him fluid and be able to follow the will of the Lord for his wife and for his family. And I just ask him to devote to me Wednesdays. He'll be coming into the office, and I'll be pouring into him. I'll be here every Wednesday night like I always am, sitting under his preaching, and that'll give me the opportunity to work with him and help train him for what I know is about to come, and that is when he pastors a church full-time. And that won't be very long, I'll promise you that, before that happens. We have talked with Brother Brian, and to ask him to do this would take about $400 a week out of his personal budget. So we make a recommendation, a motion to you, that we call Brian part-time just to help us out on an as-is basis for 6 months, and then we'll review it again at the 6 months, and he will have the preaching responsibilities on Wednesday nights, and also as he grows and I'm able to help him, then he'll begin to field, as the Lord opens up opportunities, some counseling sessions as those make themselves available. But that comes to you in the form of a motion. Would there be a second to that? Thank you, brother. Are there any questions about that? Any at all? If you would approve that, would you raise your hands? Are there any opposed? Motion carries unanimously. And the next one before you is what you have as a sheet. We just approved our bylaws, and this is something that was in our old bylaws that I believe was wise. I saw the wisdom in them doing this years ago, and that is when we call a staff member that we are to present a letter of call, and the letter of call will outline duties and responsibilities as well as pay. Let me just read it and go through it with you, and then we'll make a motion and entertain any questions. For many weeks, I've been praying for guidance from the Lord concerning pastoral help at SMBC. Through prayer, the Lord has consistently brought Tyler Bowman to my heart and mind. I have sought counsel from the deacons, laymen, and other pastors who know Tyler and SMBC. One of those was Pastor Jason this past week as well. And all the council has agreed that I proceed further with Brother Tyler, and that's wisdom I follow every day of my life. Proverbs 24:6, and a multitude of counselors, their safety. I carried this recommendation to all pastors and deacons, and there was agreement among that body as well. And today we make a formal motion to call Tyler as associate pastor at SMBC. And here are the specifics of our recommendation to call Brother Tyler. First of all, Tyler will begin a ministry as an associate pastor immediately upon an affirmative vote of the congregation, which will take place on Sunday morning, September 17th, 2023, per our church's bylaws. I would add, I didn't put this in here, that'll be a secret ballot vote, and that's just the way we do that. Number two, Tyler's responsibilities will be assigned by Brother Jonathan as follows, but I want to be clear on this, will most likely change some as our pastors find new balance of ministry responsibilities among them. We had found a wonderful balance, me, Ryan, and Joe. For the first time I'm in ministry, it was perfectly balanced, if there is such a thing, and it was. So we'll have to find that new balance. But here's where we are right now. A, we'll never change. Tyler's main function is to assist our senior pastor and lighten his load, Exodus 18:22-23, and thereby extend our pastor's ministry so that our pastor shall be able to endure, Exodus 18:23. All other responsibilities are secondary to this. Tyler will be expected to preach in the pastor's absence and assist the pastor in any task the pastor assigns for him, and that's always gone for all staff members since I've been here. Tyler's responsibilities as a youth pastor will remain unchanged. Membership. Tyler will assist the pastors with church membership. He will work diligently with other pastors to ensure, to the best of our ability, that we maintain a regenerate church membership. His duties will include overseeing the membership information class. Looks like Brother Jared Jones is going to be teaching all of that class, but Tyler will assist. Participation in new member counseling, participation in baptismal counseling. Just for the record, we baptized two this morning. We have 9 people that need to be baptized, and we have not been able to get to them. Brother Ryan and I haven't been able to get to them. We're overwhelmed. And that's just not right. And so that has to be immediately fixed. So he will participate with us in baptismal counseling. Participation in biblical counseling with members as the pastor directs. That'll be a growing thing that we help Tyler in. Senior adult ministry. Tyler will be responsible for the oversight of the ministry to senior adults. I know Mike Griffin has been helping with that. We're not going to change that at all. But Tyler will just come alongside Mike and help him to oversee the yearly planning of the senior adult ministry, participate in senior adult outings, oversee the care of senior adults. That'll be coordinating with the deacons, and maintain regular contact with our shut-ins and members. On the back, and this would be perhaps the lion's share at this time, would be education. And Tyler will be responsible to the senior pastor and other pastors for helping make and equip disciples of Jesus Christ through small groups. And that's one of the main branches of our church. He will be responsible to the senior pastor by providing leadership in all areas related to Christian training. And these were the bullet points when we called Brother Ryan on staff. Elevating small groups to be the priority ministry and making equipping disciples of Christ. Seeing that congregational ministry flows through small groups. Seeing that evangelistic outreach flows through small group ministry. Scheduling and planning necessary workers' meetings to help equip and train teachers, to work with classes and teachers in developing and training new workers, to choose educational and curriculum materials that best suit the needs of the church. That's something we do as a team. To oversee events designed to promote small groups, annual promotion day, friend days, preparation for revivals, etc. Our Blitz would be an example of that. To attend seminars designed to sharpen his skills in the ministry of small groups. I see a lot of PTI courses in the future. To work with the finance committee in providing an accurate budget for small groups, and to perform other. I gave the pastors and deacons the opportunity tonight to openly discuss this. While our need is urgent, I also don't want to get ahead, but we know Tyler. the guesswork is out of the equation. This brother has labored among us. We know him. We know his gifts. He's already risen through the channels of our church of being ordained a deacon, and that's a very intense procedure. We've already examined him multiple times in the greatest biblical scrutiny that you can, but mostly he's walked among us. And Tyler typed out his call, God's leadership of how God led him and Liz to this point, and Liz and Tyler are in agreement on this 100%, and I made sure that we worked through that so that there was no ambiguity there. But the thing I want to say to you guys is this: not everyone is going to articulate a divine call like Brother John O. I am called to preach. Brian Huffer's called to be a senior pastor of a church. But there are often men that are called within their church to be associates and to help. And that's the call Tyler is sensing. We kind of arrived at that place at the same time. As it's stated in our bylaws, I believe your first go-to is always you look within. I think you only go outside your church if you have no other recourse. But here we have a brother that is preaching and teaching once a week, every week, for the last almost 10 years. He knows our doctrine. He knows our faith. He knows our practice. We know him. We love him. We trust him. It just appears to all of us that this is hand in glove and that the Lord has brought it to be. However, we are a congregational ruled church, and we don't do anything without your final approval. But this comes as a joint motion from your senior pastor, all pastors, and all of our deacons. Would there be a second to that motion? Brother Derek Lane, thank you, brother. Now, any questions? And Tyler's here, and we'll fire questions at him if y'all want to. Surprise! But are there any questions for me or for us or for Tyler and Liz? Anything at all? It was stated, but maybe not, maybe I didn't draw attention to it, but on Sunday, September the 17th, when we vote, per our bylaws, if there's an affirmative vote, Tyler's responsibilities will begin Monday morning, that very next day. And provided that everything works out at school like it's supposed to, and I will give Tyler leeway there. But what it came down to us was this. Here's kind of the reality that we're dealing with. We don't ever do anything in a hurry, but Ryan and I are exhausted. That's just where we are. We need help. And we believe God has given us help in Brian and in Tyler. It just seems that this is the way the Lord has led us. And I am leaving in the morning to go stay with my dad. I'm going to load all my stuff up in Brother Jeff's truck, and then we're Tuesday morning driving to David Miller's place. And hopefully, when we get everything loaded in his motorhome, if it gets running, because right now it's not running, pray for that. Then we'll drive maybe 3 or 4 hours toward New Mexico, and then all day Wednesday, that'll probably be about a 13, 14-hour drive day right there. And then the next day, Thursday, we'll arrive in New Mexico, and then we'll hunt 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th. And it is an archery hunt. That's pretty much all I do, and so we will be archery hunting. But the main thing is to spend time with Brother David. And by the way, pray for him. His lungs are failing fast. I mean, fast. So pray for us for health and for strength for Brother David. And we're trying to serve our brother and help him. But I'm looking at the fact that I will be, I don't even know when I'll be back. I mean, I'll be back. But I just forgot the date. But I think I'm back on, what month is this? I think I'll be back on September the 16th, if I remember that correctly. Is that right? 17th. I'll be back preaching on the 17th. I don't know what I'll be preaching, but I'll be back on the 17th and preaching. If we had waited till then, that's 17 days, and then it would have to be 2 more weeks per our bylaws. So I hope you understand and can have compassion in the fact that that would be a whole month and a half or more before we would be able to move on this. So the brothers felt like it was prudent for us to bring it to you tonight. So there's been a motion and a second. If you would approve that, would you raise your hands, please? And what you're approving is that on September the 27th, we'll vote. Isn't that right? Have I got that right? On the 17th, we'll vote. And this will be the letter of call that will lead us. All things be done decently and in order. Amen?
Amen.
It's been good to be in the house of the Lord. And I can tell you what this does for me. I can just see a little bit of light, and that gives me hope. And it causes me to catch my breath, and I know it's that for Brother Ryan. Thank you for being patient with us. Let me ask you for this. I know you love your pastor, and I know you trust me. I want to ask you for something. For the next 2 weeks while I'm gone, his plate's not full, it's running over. Let Ryan preach. Please, don't ask anything else out of him. Don't call him. Don't text him. I'm asking you for that. That's why we have 16 deacons. That's why I put their name in the bulletin. That's why we have small group leaders. I'm just asking you as your pastor. It will clear my conscience. It will help me relax, and it'll help me be able to unwind if I know that this brother can just preach the word. Amen. Can we do that? Let's just let him come to the pulpit for the next 2 weeks full of the Holy Ghost and ready to preach. And believe me, that in and of itself is full time. And then we'll recircle the wagons and get our heads together, and we'll proceed forward after that. But I think we can pull that off for a couple of weeks, unless there's just a catastrophe, you know. And then we'll just adapt. But please, and thank you for being compassionate, and thank you for being understanding in that regard. Father, we love you, and we just thank you, God, for giving us Brian Huffer. And we look forward, Lord, to the book of Colossians and him preaching the word, Lord. And we just are thankful, Lord, that you've raised up Tyler and Liz for years, preparing them for this day. And while it may not have back yonder been something we saw, it's something you saw. And we love you, Lord, and we trust you, and we know you love your church. What a way to close the book of Revelation is your love and your care for your church, and that's what we're trying to do, Lord, is be lockstep, arm in arm with you for what's best for your church, Lord. Thank you for your wisdom that guides us, and thank you for level-headed, godly, stable men that are at the helm, Lord, that are not ruled by emotion, but ruled by the Word of God, the standard of Scripture. I praise you for that in this hour. To God be the glory, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen and amen. God bless you, church.